Not so long ago, in the vast expanse of the Pacific Ocean, there were fishermen who spent their lives on the waters, catching fish and observing the rhythms of the sea. One day they noticed something unusual. The water temperature was warmer than usual, and there was something strange happening in the currents. This was something they had never seen before. As they shared their observations with others, they began to notice a pattern. This unusual event would happen every year around Christmas time. They called it El Niño, which means the little boy or Christ child in Spanish. They believed that this phenomenon was something that God would send as it brought warmth to the cold waters during the winter months. As time went by, scientists began to study this phenomenon and discovered that El Niño was part of a larger cycle of oceanic and atmospheric changes that had far-reaching effects on weather patterns around the world. El Niño and climate change will be a very dangerous mix for temperatures on Earth in the next 5 years, the World Meteorological Organization stated 2 weeks ago. There's still no certainty, but it's now increasingly likely that global temperatures will reach record highs in the next 5 years, fueled by heat-trapping greenhouse gases and El Niño. This will have far-reaching repercussions for health, food safety, water management, and the environment, and this could happen as soon as 2024. We might want to be prepared. Keep watching the video to get to know more about it. Anchovies and El Niño. Everything started with anchovies. Before they wind up on a pizza or in a tin can with a rollaway lid, anchovies are in the ocean. Colorful Peruvian boats in the 60s used to return to shore each day heavy with thousands of anchovies. This was a blessing for the people living in the dry climate along the coast of Peru and Ecuador, who found it tough to farm the land. These anchovies were a vital source of food and income for them. But one day in 1972, the fishermen returned with their nets empty, and everyone was disappointed. The seabirds, who usually feasted on the anchovies, were starving to death. The fishermen noticed something strange. The water was warmer than usual, and other types of fish had appeared, but there were no anchovies. The skies were dark and cloudy, and the air was humid instead of dry. These happenings, which would occur every few years, were given a name by the people there, El Niño. Today we know El Niño is an essential part of a weather phenomenon called El Niño Southern Oscillation, or ENSO. And it doesn't just impact the fish in Peru, it affects the entire planet. Understanding why the anchovies were dying is really useful to understand why El Niño actually is and the impact it has on the Earth. Imagine being a little anchovy swimming in the ocean off the coast of Peru. Life is good because the water is cold and rich in nutrients. This is thanks to a process called upwelling, which is like an elevator for water from the depths of the sea. You see, along the west coast of South America, wind blows north and pushes the surface water away from the coast. This creates a space for the nutrient-rich deep water to rise up and feed the hungry phytoplankton. And where there's phytoplankton, there's zooplankton. And when there's zooplankton, there's food for anchovies. But sometimes something called El Niño happens. This is like a temper tantrum in the ocean caused by changes in the wind patterns. When El Niño hits, upwelling slows down and the anchovies get confused, like a lost fish in a sea of uncertainty. Fishermen try to catch them in the usual places, but the fish are nowhere to be found. This means there's less fish to eat, which is bad news for us humans who like to enjoy good anchovy pizza or Caesar salad. Understanding why anchovies die off during El Niño is important because it helps us understand the bigger picture of how our planet works. Just like how a small change in the wind can affect the ocean, small changes in one part of the world can have big impacts elsewhere. It's like a game of Jenga, where one block pulled out can bring the whole tower tumbling down. So let's be mindful of our actions and their effects on the world around us. El Niño and climate change in 2024. It's easy now to draw some conclusions about what El Niño actually is. It is an oscillation of the ocean atmosphere system in the tropical Pacific, having important consequences for weather around the globe. This phenomenon is characterized by unusually warm ocean temperatures in the equatorial Pacific. The warming of the ocean causes disastrous floods and can also lead to devastating brush fires, as seen in Australia. The occurrence of El Niño is closely monitored, as it is essential for predicting short-term climate variations. The brush fires in Australia during the black summer of 2019-2020 were a result of weak El Nino conditions, combined with colder than average ocean temperatures in the eastern Indian Ocean. These conditions promote drier conditions in the southern and eastern parts of the country, and often, but not always, coincide with El Nino. This said, the World Meteorological Organization, WMO, has recently released a bold and concerning update about our planet's future. With the combination of El Nino and human-induced climate change, global temperatures will likely hit record-level highs within the next 5 years. The WMO report states that there is a 66% chance that global temperatures will be at least 1.5 degrees Celsius higher than pre-industrial levels for 1 year between 2023 and 2027. Additionally, there is a 98% chance that at least one of those 5 years will be the hottest on record. It is reasonable to think this will happen in 2024. Although El Nino occurs naturally, it is expected to increase global temperatures in the coming months, leading to unpredictable outcomes for health, food safety, water management, and the environment. According to Petteri Talas, WMO Secretary General, we must prepare ourselves for the repercussions of this dangerous mix. Moreover, compared to the 1991 to 2020 average, Arctic warming is predicted to be 3 times greater than the anticipated global anomaly over the next 5 extended Northern Hemisphere winters. Additionally, the report suggests that precipitation patterns will shift, with increased rainfall in certain areas and decreased rainfall in others. The impact of human-induced greenhouse gases is also causing higher acidity levels in oceans, melting sea ice and glaciers, rising sea levels, and more extreme weather patterns. The Paris Agreement emphasizes the need for all nations to significantly reduce greenhouse gas emissions to prevent the planet from warming beyond 2 degrees Celsius, with further efforts to limit the increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change warns that climate-related risks will be higher if global warming exceeds 1.5 degrees Celsius, requiring us to act fast to reduce these harmful impacts. We must prioritize climate action to ensure a sustainable future for our planet. However, it's not all doom and gloom. El Nino may be dangerous, but it's not the only player in the game. There's also La Nina, which is characterized by unusually cold ocean temperatures in the equatorial Pacific. La Nina brings the opposite effects of El Nino, and it can lead to increased rainfall in drought-prone regions. While El Nino may cause some damage, it's not all bad news. We can anticipate its occurrence and prepare for its consequences. In the same vein, La Nina brings relief from drought conditions and can be a welcome respite to communities affected by El Nino. We should approach these weather phenomena with caution and respect, but we need not to be overly alarmed. Technical explanation of El Nino. To truly grasp the origins of El Nino, one must first take a closer look at the normal state of the Pacific Ocean affected by ENSO. The trade wind system in this region, which is responsible for prevailing winds, plays a crucial role in the formation of El Nino. Near the equator is a zone of low pressure referred to as the doldrums. In contrast, the primary high pressure systems found 30 degrees north and south of the equator are called the horse latitudes. Due to uneven heating, the sun warms up the tropical regions of the western Pacific, causing the air in these areas to rise into the atmosphere. As this hot air moves towards the doldrums, it is deflected westward when it reaches the equator, shaped by the Coriolis effect. The Coriolis force is an additional acceleration acting on the motion of bodies in a rotating system, like the Earth. This plays an essential role in determining the direction of the trade winds. As a result of the Coriolis effect, the northeast and southeast trade winds are formed, named for their point of origin. These winds combine to create the normal trade wind system, which sweeps air westward along the equator of the Pacific. These winds also create gyres, vast ocean-spanning currents carrying surface water westward, which are maintained by the prevailing winds. This results in a change in the depth of the water. As the surface water moves west, it is replaced by cooler subsurface water, referred to as upwelling. As a result, the sea level in the eastern Pacific along the equator is typically half a meter lower than in the western Pacific, where warm surface water has gathered into a warm pool. The water temperatures in the west are often 8 degrees Celsius higher than those in the east, around South America due to the upwelling of these cooler subsurface waters. The prevailing winds also cause high levels of rainfall over Indonesia and Southeast Asia due to the moisture of the winds as they traverse the Pacific. During El Niño, this entire system undergoes a transformation that impacts the environment on a global scale. Hey, if you're still here, it means you're really enjoying the video. Why don't you press the like button? It would help us a lot. Thanks. Different areas affected by El Niño. If you wonder how El Niño can affect your area, here's a nice overview. In the vast expanse of South America, El Niño reigns supreme, throwing caution to the wind and wreaking havoc with the weather patterns of the continent. The western coast of South America, which is usually dry and desolate, experiences unusually high levels of rainfall, leading to floods of catastrophic proportions. This phenomenon is caused due to the warming of the surface waters in the Pacific, which leads to a decrease in the oxygen levels in the sea. The resulting scarcity of fish has severe economic implications, particularly in Peru and Ecuador. The eastern region of South America, encompassing countries like Brazil and Argentina, witnesses a surge in atmospheric humidity during summers. The winters, on the other hand, are mild and lack the usual snowfall associated with the season. In North America, El Niño operates differently depending on the latitude. The Caribbean and the southern parts of the USA are pelted with heavy showers, causing utter chaos on some occasions. As one moves northwards from Oregon to Alaska, the warming of the surface water leads to milder winters and springs with higher temperatures. Moving on to Australia and southern Polynesia, El Niño triggers drought-like conditions, drastically reducing rainfall levels. Some archipelagos, like Tahiti and Hawaii, witness an increase in tropical cyclones, triggered by El Niño. Japan and Korea are enveloped in a blanket of warmth, leading to sultry summers and mild winters. However, southern Asia, stretching from Indonesia to India, isn't as lucky, as the temperature increase is accompanied by a significant decrease in rainfall, leading to severe droughts that can last for years. In Africa, El Niño's impact is most felt in the southeastern portion of the continent, which is ravaged by droughts and higher temperatures. However, the Horn of Africa witnesses a spike in rainfall. In Europe, the effects of El Niño are yet to be fully understood. They are less severe and have a lighter impact. El Niño changes the rotation of the Earth. So we kind of understand what El Niño is and how it acts on a global scale. But perhaps one of the most interesting effects it has on the Earth is to change its rotation rate. Here's how it goes. Think of the Earth as a figure skater spinning on the ice. As the skater spins, they bring their arms closer to their body, which causes them to spin faster. This is because of the conservation of angular momentum requires that the skater's rate of rotation increases as they decrease their arm radius. Similarly, during an El Niño, the Earth's atmosphere experiences change in wind patterns, which results in a redistribution of mass around the planet. In order to conserve total angular momentum, the Earth's rotation rate decreases to compensate for these changes. This may seem like a small change, but even a small adjustment in the Earth's rotation can have big consequences, such as altering weather patterns and causing changes in sea level. So just like a figure skater, the Earth can adjust its rotation rate to accommodate changes in the atmosphere. Today, we continue to monitor and study El Niño as a way of predicting global weather patterns and understanding the effects of climate change on our planet. So next time you order a pizza with anchovies or an open tin can with rollaway lids, remember the story of how the lives of anchovies and people in Peru are closely linked to the El Niño Southern Oscillation. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching. What are your thoughts about El Niño? Let us know in the comments below. We'll see you next time.